Mr. Bharat Rathod and Dr. Dali Mishra deserve our congratulations and best wishes. Corona and terrorism compared for finding solution. The efforts of the forces and government machinery, let's recognize, are facing increasingly limitations in their abilities to deal with the challenge. It is now indeed important that education and research institutions play a vital role in designing and disseminating material that bring value addition to these individuals and institutions. In other words, we have to employ the strategies and experiments like several universities world over are doing to find vaccination for corona. Learning from the developments happening in the medical research world, I have all the reasons to be optimist that a consortium of academic institutions can too significantly take upon the terrorism challenge. Corona crisis has shown us the way. When an individual is directly affected, regardless of race, creed, caste, sex, nationality, he or she is willing to take all measures, willing to bring all pressures, willing to cooperate with other human beings and institutions, willing to observe all hardships like lockdowns to prevent him or herself from being medically or physically affected. Look at the billions of dollars pledged by all countries together, and we hope that the COVID will soon be history. Imagine the leaders, the governments indeed have an ability to deal with the challenge just in few months. Now let's see how many people have died of terrorist and insurgency attacks. United Nations, NATO, and government agencies are certainly having good data, imperfect as it can be. But I'm sure the number of victims outweigh multiple times than corona-related deaths. I'm not comparing the economic, cultural, social havoc the dual threats have created across the land boundaries and in oceans too for now many years. Cannot Indian Prime Minister Modi, Russian President Putin, US President Trump, French President Macron, British Premier Johnson, Chinese President Xi take the same fast, forward and coordinated steps and strategies at global level to deal with the challenge of terrorism and insurgency? They can and they shall. As India assumes non-permanent membership in the UN Security Council, India, one of the most affected countries in the world, can indeed take and like steps to mobilize all possible efforts like it has done for corona pandemic. Corona pandemic has already brought economic, social devastations, created boundaries between people and civilizations, the way terrorism has brought now for decades. As much as continuation of even single day of corona costs billions of dollars and thousands of lives, the continuation of terrorism, even a single day, creates havoc in the peace, security, and stability among nations and within nations. I have reviewed reports which show how corona has generated or contributed online radicalization, how pandemic created silence has been strategically abused by terrorists and insurgents across the globe. But friends, I would strike a second note of optimism. The same pandemic has acutely created awareness among educated as well as non-educated, rich or poor, about value of individual life. And we have seen how a small child of 2 years, it could be in the Netherlands, or an elderly person of 85 years in a remote part of India, has been caring for himself and for others too. The sense of protecting oneself and other from intentional or unintentional harm is the greatest positive lesson the whole globe has learned. Should not we then think and care for the same vis-a-vis our fight against terrorism? The fight against terrorism has to be seen in the similar enlightened manner. We can all dispute and debate about the cause and source and spread of corona. We agree, we disagree, but have you seen that our response is the same? Let's fight it out and remove corona from the world. This deep humanist thinking and approach is a source of great strength as we deal with terrorism. Thus, my first and foremost suggestion to the faculty and participants is to draw applicable parallels for solution and keep faith in our collective abilities to deal with this threat as well. The complete lockdown called upon by the Indian Prime Minister Modi for nearly 70 days and its mega impact in enhancing India's overall ability to deal with the crisis is a source of great inspiration. I'm sure the Prime Minister Modi can and will be able to bring such an enlightened approach at the global level for the terrorism threat as well. The ideas can but germinate from enlightened faculty and caring participants in the forum like this one. Hence, I'm particularly happy that the School of Internal Security and Police Administration of this university has organized this 2 week long program. Best stories in eliminating terrorism and insurgency. In order to eliminate a particular problem, governments and organizations like the United Nations bring out disseminated best practices. The International Maritime Organizations, the Interpol, the Financial Action Task Force, best practices serve useful guides to us all. Integration of financial intelligence and disrupting terrorism. Friends, as we know, there are challenges in designating and more so effectively implementing the asset freezing measures of designated individuals and institutions. The United Nations, in its June 2020 report, brings out these findings very acutely. I believe an informal alliance, like international alliance, enabling integration of financial intelligence into counter-terrorism efforts, enhanced and specialized investigative and enforcement capabilities, and robust legal frameworks to keep pace with the rapid evolution in financial tools and terrorism financing method will give strong results. While these are indeed wish lists of the executive, what needs to be done is institutions like RSU, in collaboration with a couple of like-minded global institutions, can create a small pilot research task force, bringing researchers dealing with terrorism, artificial intelligence, finance, and general intelligence. In other words, challenges before the executive have to be translated into academic and research laboratories, and the recommendations have to be fed into the executive machinery again. It is indeed possible. RSU would be happy to support a dedicated task force of international and national researchers who can work with precision. NATO has a well-established counterinsurgency and counterterrorism mechanism consisting of academicians, executive, and operational forces. RSU can think of establishing collaboration with this mechanism. The Tech Against Terrorism 2017 initiative of the United Nations. Let's be reminded that academic partnerships are as crucial as executive partnerships for dealing with the problem. Governments may prevent from continuously failing if continuous feedback and research are obtained from academic and research community. Models of dealing with insurgency in Malaysia, Sri Lanka, Singapore, although fortunately outdated, can still have some relevance. And we must learn from those unfortunate lessons too. There are good amount of literature on insurgency, but what I would still emphasize is to learn strategic insurgency models and see the parallels and differences between these models. Are there, for example, similarities between the Moro conflict model of Philippines, or let's say security issues and indigenous groups in Guyana, Suriname, and French Guianas? What I'm trying to say is, one should and one can look beyond the boundaries to find such solutions. While addressing the counterinsurgency, we all are reminded that we need to have two approaches: enemy-centric and people-centric. This dualist strategy brings more desired results in the long run. What could be tactics, techniques, and procedures for dealing with insurgency in different parts of India? Both enemy-centric and population-centric counter-insurgency methods have achieved some notable successes, and I would also add some spectacular failures, as the latest NATO study shows. There is a debate whether we need a comprehensive convention on terrorism, measures designed to enhance compliance with existing treaties and resolutions are more urgently needed than a new whole convention. But it is argued that such convention would be a whole new improvement in the present situation. The definition of terrorism is the, and I emphasize, is the bottleneck, particularly in view of the fact that there exists regional definitions which appear to be inordinately wide and make it very difficult to distinguish acts of terrorism from ordinary offenses. In view of this, adoption at the United Nations level will fill the existing gaps and further reduce the risk that some states may serve as safe havens or shelters for terrorist activities. It can also reduce the negative effects of some excessive regional definitions. The failure of the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1373 of 28 September 2001 is precisely because of the lack of definition. As one of the writers observed, the adoption of an agreed definition at a world level would serve as a basis for the development of a customary rule for the prosecution of terrorist acts under the principle of universal jurisdiction, irrespective of whether or not they amount to war crimes or to crimes against humanity. It is suggested that there is a need for a mechanism for the international prosecution of terrorist offenses, irrespective of whether or not they qualify as war crimes or as crimes against humanity. There is a need for a fine balance between international human rights law and terrorism. All states have right to defend themselves against terrorism and to take the necessary measures to guarantee their security and integrity, including the right to incriminate behaviors that threaten their security and integrity. In so doing, these states are required to respect international law, including international human rights law. But my experience and readings of jurisprudence suggest that this issue is politically divisive, an excuse in the hands of few. Why? Because domestic judiciary of states do keep balance and always strive to respect for human rights obligations of states. The judiciary try to balance between national security and integrity and observance of rights and needs for individual justice. Counterinsurgency and counterterrorism at global and national level will always remain work in progress. Terrorism is not only a convenient term for circumscribing certain activities which are widely disapproved of. Rather, in using this terminology, a national or international community expresses a strong condemnation and stigmatization of certain acts committed by individuals or groups. It is important to state that this condemnation does not turn terrorists into outlaws, but it is equally important to note that the symbolic effects of the condemnation depend on the moral authority behind the legal approach, as Walter observes. The moral reasons for strongly condemning terrorism mainly lie in it turning innocent civilians into instruments for the pursuit of political goals. Such a moral reading grounds the reasons for condemning terrorism in considerations of human dignity. Any differentiation according to the authors of the acts or the situation in which they occur cannot but weaken the moral authority of the condemnation, and along with it, diminish the symbolic effects of terrorism as a legal concept, and should hence be avoided to the largest extent possible. In the last 2 decades, one notices that there is no justification for terrorist acts. No philosophical, no moral, no historical, no ideological reasons may be adduced to legitimate terrorism. Isn't it the case that the terrorism acts are so horrendous? They shock the conscience of the international community to such an extent and degree that no balancing of interest is admitted. The terrorist act is characterized by a political element, but this element does not suffice to furnish it with any justification. On the contrary, it classifies it as a crime that affects the interest of humankind as a whole. Public international law requires states to take action against terrorism. There is a human right obligation to do so. But this is also, of course, a broader duty under general international law. Obviously, states have an obligation not to engage in or support acts of terrorism themselves. That much is self-evident, but it is also a long-established principle of customary international law that states have an obligation to take whatever means are at their disposal to prevent their territory from being used as a base for terrorist attack on others. That is an obligation which, unfortunately, is all too easily ignored by certain states. Any act of international terrorism is a threat to all states and peoples and needed to be addressed as such. There can be no more room for thinking of any terrorist group or as someone else's problem, still less of trying to justify terrorist acts by reference to the goal which a group seeks to achieve. The threat posed by a group like Al-Qaeda, ISIS, is a threat to the life of all nations. And I believe that a country is entitled to rely on that to justify derogating from certain conventional and treaty obligations, even if others choose not to follow that example. Like the United Kingdom itself advocated and practiced in the last decade, and there is currently a controversy. The point is that the concept of a threat to the life of the nation must today be seen in terms of a threat to the international polity in a much broader sense. We all agree that we must not allow the fight against terrorism to destroy the very values which we seek to protect from the terrorist. Is torture ever justified? No, it is not. Everyone who suggests that there is a necessity to conduct torture in certain circumstances would do well to remember what US President Eisenhower once said about military necessity, that it all too easily becomes confused with military convenience. There is not a path down which any one of us can afford to go, nor can we accept a policy of abandoning due process after arrest and detention. We cannot afford to run the policy of round the usual suspects practiced by the prefect in the film Casablanca. The famous Chahal case in the United Kingdom, the effect of that in most of the countries of Europe is that if such a person cannot be deported, then he has to be released. An unattractive proposition when there is a good reason to suspect that person of serious terrorist conduct. That is what has led the British government to derogate from Article 5 of the European Convention. It is a derogation of an extremely limited character. All it does is to provide that where somebody cannot be deported from the United Kingdom because of the effect of the Chahal decision, and there is evidence which shows that they are involved in international terrorism, then they can be detained. Friends, legislation passed in Canada subsequent to 9/11 has been described as the most liberal and including a set of safeguards and protections for civil liberties that compared to the provisions in UK and USA does not exist elsewhere. So we already see that there are fragmentations in law, fragmentations in practices, fragmentations in jurisprudence within the European Union, between the Atlantic neighbors, and of course, in the Asian countries as well. Thus, in summing up, I would say that states have an absolute obligation and shall use all means at its disposal to fulfill their obligation to protect the safety and security of their population. Second, like any other field of life and governance, the field of dealing with insurgency and terrorism is dynamic. There are neither permanent solutions nor permanent policy response, and no permanent legislation and no permanent treaties. Terrorism in all its form remain condemned and must be eliminated. Few governments can afford lingering on the definition of terrorism as a pretext for not having the comprehensive convention on terrorism. In the absence of convention, individual states will have its own definition, form, content, and process to deal with terrorism using its sovereign will and power. European nations, France and UK, have interesting deviations and have begun to strike a balance between punishing the terrorists and ensuring the safety and security of their population, even if that requires interpretation that may be at variance with those who afford luxury of preaching, as they may have not been directly affected by the scourge of terrorism. As India assumes non-permanent membership of the UN Security Council, it is expected from this nation that it will put, and it shall put, its best effort to reach an international agreement to deal with menace of terrorism with peace-loving other members in the Council and the United Nations as a whole. It is also pertinent that Raksha Shakti University, in collaboration with the United Nations Counter-Terrorism Executive Directorate and NATO, keeps deliberating the evolving nature of the insurgency and terrorism and find academic and research solutions as the fights against these threats go on. I'm indeed thankful to my colleagues and all research faculty for their valuable time in joining first of its kind program on counterinsurgency and counterterrorism, and look forward to your contribution to RSU upcoming academic and research training programs in all aspects of security and police. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable time, sir. And thank you for enlightening us on various issues related to terrorism and international law. And now I would like to request our respected keynote speaker, Lieutenant General Dushyant Singh, sir. He is an Emeritus Resource Faculty at our university, Raksha Shakti University, in the School of Border Management and Intelligence, and School of Counterinsurgency and Counterterrorism also. He is a retired DG of Army War College now. He sir was commissioned into the 9th Battalion of the Maratha Light Infantry Regiment. He has attended the Regional Defense Counter-Terrorism Program with specialization in terrorist operations and financing in US. He has served in varied terrains and theater of operations in India as well as UN as military observer. He has been an instructor of human resource development in College of Defense Management in Secunderabad. During his entire service, sir has been awarded Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, Param Vishisht Seva Medal. Besides these, he has been contributing regularly various defense journals and newspapers also. He has also written various book chapters and has been writing regularly in newspaper, militaries, journals and website also. Now, I would like to request our respected keynote speaker, Lieutenant General Dushyant Singh sir, give a keynote address. Over to you, sir.
Welcome. Thank you, everyone. Professor Dr. Bimal Patel, DG Raksha Shakti University, member National Security Advisory Board of India, Dr. K.V. Ravi Kumar, Dean and FAA RSU, the distinguished faculty of the RSU, eminent speakers, guests, and above all, the participants of the two-week advanced certificate course on CICT. A very good morning to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I would like to thank RSU for having given me this opportunity to deliver the keynote address and be part of their resource faculty to impart knowledge to the youth of our country. It is a humbling feeling for me to share the knowledge gained during the course of 39 years of my long service career with our youth. I must also emphasize that it is a two-way process. And I also expect to learn from your young and creative minds as we go along in this course program. Fortunately or unfortunately, keynote speaker normally sets the stage for an academic event or a seminar. However, Dr. Bimal has already covered a lot of ground. I shall therefore very briefly add to the flavor of terrorism and insurgency at global and national level already provided by Dr. Bimal. It would not be out of place to state that warfare has always been part of human history from the very beginning of human life on the earth. Only the form and the nature has transformed. Martin Van Creveld predicted in 1991 in his book, The Transformation of War, that practices which for three centuries were considered uncivilized, mark my words, such as capturing civilians and even entire communities for ransom, are almost certain to make a comeback. Example of IC-814 is very live in our minds. He further goes on to add, to state that the low intensity conflict will be the order of the day. I shall deliberate a little more on this later. My own experience has been that the world is already swamped with insurgencies and terror movements. Over 200 terrorist movements are ongoing as of today all over the world. Future will only see growth in the emergence of radical movements, insurgencies, and terrorism. This trend will be more pronounced in countries with multiple fault lines of religion, caste, color, and division of a homogeneous demography by artificial international borders drawn earlier by our colonial masters. Example of Kurds, Baloch, Nagas, JNK are abound. In short, the Che Guevara's, Mao's, Hafiz Saeed, Azhar Mahmood, and Fidel Castro's of the world will be only increasing. We must also be conscious of the fact that international disputes have a history of resurfacing in odd ways. We are witnessing this phenomena in the context of India also. While it was always presumed that Pakistan and China, being our sworn enemies, would always impede our peace, growth, and stability by periodically raising contentious issues at various levels, jumping in of Nepal into the fray should not surprise us. And so therefore, we need to be prepared for such eventualities. However, would our adversary at this stage involve himself in a conventional war? My guess is the answer is no. High cost of waging even a limited war is unaffordable, especially during the corona times, as has been highlighted by Dr. Bimal himself. It is because of this that we are witnessing increasing number of proxy wars being waged by states through their non-state terror or insurgent proxies. Iran, Pakistan, and even US and Russia are prominent examples of this phenomenon. I would like to validate my statement through a specific example. US has already spent over $6.4 trillion in the Middle East and Asia while fighting there. In this process, the world has lost 801,000 lives, including 335,000 civilians. Imagine the colossal loss of lives because of the wars. US intervened through a conventional war fighting in the Middle East and has done so at huge cost. Ultimately, it has been confronted by a non-conventional war fighting non-state actors such as ISIS and AQ and Taliban. It has learned its lesson and is now, my reports say, indulging in proxies through its non-state or state actors. Similarly, Pakistan has waged a long-drawn proxy war with India rather than getting involved conventionally to avoid a huge cost of waging a conventional war. I dare say its strategy has been successful. In JNK, it has inflicted on India 42,000 casualties since 1992. And if we were to add the figures of Punjab militancy, these numbers would only increase. What I'm getting at is that by waging a low intensity conflict, countries are able to avoid the high cost of conventional war fighting. Pakistan's strategy of baiting India through 1,000 cuts at minimum cost is achieving almost similar results as by spending huge amount of money by the United States. So what I'm hinting at is that we will witness a transformation in war, wherein non-military means of waging warfare will gain preference and prominence over the conventional war fighting in times to come. So it becomes incumbent on the part of Indian security professionals to be fully aware of the nuances of terrorism and insurgency, which will be the main tool along with cyber warfare, electronic warfare, etc. We should also be conscious of the fact that security forces cannot bring peace by themselves. The aim of security organizations is to create conditions at the ground level to enable political process to seek a lasting solution. We intend to take the participants through this journey of security operations to deal with insurgencies and terrorism during the course of this program. Therefore, what I foresee is that the future warfare scenario clearly points to a world where non-military, non-contact and technology-driven warfare with a very high content of artificial intelligence will be the norm in the future. Combating terrorism, insurgencies, proxy wars and cyber wars would demand involvement of not only the security agencies, but other organizations of the state machinery. A whole of nation approach is necessary to deal with wars that are driven by human dynamics. Note the emphasis on human dynamics. People participation, academia's help will be as important as the involvement of security forces. And it is here that I see a very large role for Raksha Shakti University. Other government agencies such as external affairs, information, broadcasting, HRD, and finance will also play an important role in tackling terrorism and insurgencies. In our context, we are facing multiple insurgencies and terror movements. JNK has a major external content in the form of Pakistan. Nagaland and Manipur militancies were earlier supported by China, but now their level of support has fallen down. However, lack of influence of the Myanmar government in the border areas enables Naga militants to move about freely and establish camps in Myanmar, from where they keep making forays into the Indian territory and attack the security forces. The Naxal Belt is a left ideology driven movement, which begs high quality of policing and paramilitary action to control the militant groups and their leaders, followed by a focused program for elevation of economy, social and cultural problems of the Naxal affected tribal population. The course program, I'm sure, will briefly expose the participants to these insurgencies, as also conduct some actual case studies to expose them to the nuances of ground level tackling of militant insurgents or terror strikes. With that, I wish to conclude my talk in the hope that each one of you will make the best of this opportunity, enrich yourself with the doctrines, concepts, planning, conduct, and execution of CICT operations effectively. Once again, I wish to thank Dr. Bimal and the entire faculty of RSU for having given me this opportunity to interact with the young students and security professionals of our country and be of some value in their endeavor to be of acquiring specialized and pragmatic knowledge on a contemporary subject of universal concern. Thank you. Jai Hind to all of you.
Jai Hind, sir. Thank you for your kind address, sir, and your fruitful, valuable information. And now I would like to invite my other colleagues, Mr. Bhavani Singh Rathod, and I would like to hand over this session to you, sir. Over to you, sir.
I, Bhavani Singh Rathod, Assistant Professor and Coordinator of School of Counterinsurgency and Counterterrorism, RSU, on behalf of school, we'd like to thank our Director General, Professor Dr. Bimal N. Patel, sir, for motivating and encouraging us. We also like to thank our Dean Faculty Affairs and Academic, Sri K.V. Ravi Kumar, sir, for constantly guiding us for the success of this event. We would like to thank our Registrar, sir, Sri Pawan Soni, for their administrative and financial support. We thank all our resource persons for accepting our invitation and being the part of this first of its kind online certificate course. We also thank all eminent and learned faculties of RSU for their support. We would also like to thank our support team volunteer for providing all logistical support. Last but not the least, we thank all the participants to be part of this first of its kind 2-week online advanced certificate course on counterinsurgency and counterterrorism. We look forward for fruitful online learning. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. And the next session for the day will start 2:30. The speakers for the next session are Captain Ismita Gaikwad, and second speaker is the Lieutenant General Dusan Singh, sir. So we will meet at 2:30. Thank you for joining the inaugural session. Thank you, all of you.